and welcome everyone back, and I'll now go to the call meeting back to order. As indicated, we are going to actually hear on the Johnson Street Bridge Public Realm Elements, item number 4 on your agenda. There we'll go in camera and then pop back up. So with that, we'll allow Mr. Sparanese to introduce our guests and introduce the item.
Good afternoon, Your Worship and Council. We're here today to present to you the public realm elements of the Johnson Street Bridge project. For Council's information, who I have here with us this afternoon in terms of the speaking is Mr. Kalinchuk, the project director, will speak to you regarding the background and how we got to where we are today in terms of the pathway, landscape, and plaza spaces and the discussions with the community. And the specific plan that's going to be presented today regarding the look and feel and some of the elements that are incorporated into the plan as of recently in terms of tree species types, etc., is Ken Marson with Sharp and Diamond. He's our landscape architect for the project. And then we have Ken Jarvella as our project manager. So without further, I'll turn it over to Dwayne just to give you some background into how we got to where we are.
So in June and July of this year, the city had two information sessions to seek input on the public realm elements for the public on the Johnson Street Bridge replacement project. In addition to that, we received 124 surveys. Of all that information, the common themes that were identified was a desire for enhanced walkability, cycling connections, and improving overall accessibility, supporting opportunities for social gatherings through community events, festivals, and entertainment in the plaza areas and a new green space area, creating opportunities to view the harbor, improving overall safety and introducing elements to encourage traffic calming, and the approaches are considered gateways to the neighborhoods. When asked where to prioritize the public realm money, the top priorities were investing in landscaping, plaza amenities, pathway lighting, and pedestrian cycling, cyclist safety. So out of all that, the proposed enhancements that were a result of this input that were presented to you back in July were issues such as the connectivity. This was the separated sidewalks on the west approach, where space allows wayfinding signage to direct pedestrians and cyclists, intersection with four marked crosswalks at the Esquimalt Harbor Road intersection. We added a sidewalk on the south side of Esquimalt Road to improve pedestrian connectivity across the bridge. Enhancing crossings for pedestrians and cyclists, in particular at the northeast trailhead where said development speed are going to be crossing is going to be installed to assist cyclists in accessing from the road onto the multi-use trail. Okay, so at Elephant's Foot's crossing is a crossing that has a big distinction of square blocks, and what that means with the green done in the middle, it means it's a crossing where it's legal for bikes to go through. Right now, according to the Highway Traffic Act, a bike cannot go through a pedestrian crossing. A bike is supposed to be on the road surface itself. But these crossings, which actually you see a fair amount of in downtown Vancouver now with all their bikeways, is a new terminology in the Transport Association of Canada, and it's now called elephant speed crossings. No animals will suffer during the production of these crosswalks. So we're also putting in a left turn lane for cyclists off of War Street going onto the bridge, going onto the multi-use trail. We also are looking at recognizing the Northwest Trail Junction potential as a meeting point and opportunities for the wayfinding signage, and we also are ensuring connections to the David Foster Way. With respect to traffic calming, measures installed or proposed are raised medians for traffic calming effects on the west and east sides, landscape median on the west side of the harbor, and a tree median on the east approach into downtown. The Delta Ocean Point Resort and future public space access road was reduced to two narrow lanes. There was some concern about the width of that approach. We're minimizing the left turn lane length of the intersection of Squamble and Harbor Roads, and there's consideration of banner installation on the west side median to serve as traffic calming and a gateway feature for Victoria West. With respect to the plaza areas, plaza space in the southwest is designed for harbor view, including seating, lighting, and utilities for potential future programming. Plaza space in the northeast is designated. made for trail connection with bicycle racks and a drinking fountain. And staff are going to look for opportunities in the future for programming to be entertained over the years when it's completed. With respect to landscaping, the input from the public is now going to have a mixture of ornamental native plantings and trees with bedrocks were appropriate, so it's very much a natural theme and we can cancel for that in a few minutes. And lastly, the treatment of the retaining walls, we are exploring with our team to make sure that there is some architectural treatment to the retaining walls that will reduce graffiti but also make it look a lot more appealing, just bare faced concrete. So with that, I'm going to turn over to Ken to just go through a PowerPoint. And this really focuses on the public realm document that you received. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dwayne, for the introduction and Peter for organizing this. What I'm going to talk about today is essentially a summary of the two spaces, the downtown and the Victoria West side, and the individual components within those spaces, which will focus on the servicing treatments, the types of planting treatments, furnishings, lighting, walls, and a brief summary of sustainability about the entire project. So the summary plan really is a summary of the program that we went through, the consultation process, and the resultant spaces are approximately about 4.5 acres plus or minus, and they're primarily based about we use the inspiration of the adjacent character areas. We look to the natural landscape. We want to make sure all those pathways are great, accessible connections, and ultimately achievable for pedestrian and cyclist movement. So we're focusing on the downtown side. There's four primary components here, and those are the rendered sections that you see there. So the space to the top, you're all familiar now, is loosely referred to as the Galloping Goose Trailhead. And View Plaza will be a planted and tree median along the roadway edge, textured servicing and flexible space for future programming that could happen for the gym. The central triangle space is fairly similar to what you have now. It'll be a formal lawn space. We've widened the pedestrian sidewalk along here for a couple of reasons. We wanted people to be able to pause a little bit and look. There's a space for viewing down the center line of the bridge and see the magnificent structure there. Space for future public art, and we wanted enough room to save one of the significant oak trees in the corner there. The Wharf Street Boulevard improvements are fairly simple. It's just ensuring that sidewalk stays, the existing trees stay, there's a monument there, so essentially that will more or less stay intact. There's an additional raised plant medium down the center lanes, and that will be a hard surface with fastidia trees lining the roadway. That'll act as a bit of traffic calming, also providing a green gateway, and also to simulate at a bigger scale what the trees that you have there are. The last space is essentially the terminus of Johnson Street. This is probably the most interesting space. It's first major improvement is the intersection of Harbor Road and Sequoia Malt, and that's for a number of reasons to slow traffic down, a bit of a pause before you get to the bridge, and essentially you're framed by a green parkway-like entrance. Over the head is the multi-use overpass and the connection to the Galapagos Trail. Area to the south is the future S-curve, or it's the existing S-curve area that will become a future park design here. And another spectacular viewing space utilizing the existing abutment of the old bridge as a view deck to look back at the park. A simple rendering looking east and from the downtown pedestrian park connection off of the bridge. Essentially, you'll be walking up the slope to get you up to the intersection there through a green park-like space. Future connections to the David Foster Way have been taken into account. So the bridge heights are high enough so that you can get under, and then you can also get down to the adjacent lands, which would be the northern junk, or the junk site. By the way, that red tube in the middle there is not a giant garbage can. It's a future placeholder for the orientation and wayfinding system. So when people come off the bridge, they know where they're going. Looks kind of funny. Well, we're also retaining a handful of the existing oak trees that are in this sloped area here. We're clustering in rock clusters that it is abundant seating for people to catch sunsets and so on.
Through your worship, I just want to point out the one area that's for future consideration is just that the immediate area over here where the existing parking lot is and as it works itself towards the Northern Junk building itself. This is just showing a conceptualization of what occurs there, because what exists right now is the parking lot area and retaining wall, just so for council's knowledge.
In the short term, all of the green triangular spaces in the boulevard would still be in place prior to Victoria West.
Councillor Gudgeon has a question.
Oh.
Just on that last slide. Just the embankment down at the water's edge, is that just going to be concrete?
Well, no. The existing abutment is concrete, yes. And to the right of the screen is the existing rock slope and informal landscape that's there.
So it will be like, it'll continue on in that vein of rock kind of retaining
home. Through your worship, yeah, I think that's that immediate area, and maybe Dwayne can point out where the existing abutment is. So this is where the bridge is today,
yeah.
There, and the other wall right to the right side of it. But as you move along there, that is rock riprap, and so that's something that would have to be planned as part of the continuation of the David Foster Wake pathway itself. That there's riprap there, and that's to be conceptualized as that continues to advance.
So the parking lot's just above that riprap right now.
It's not as great.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah.
So you don't have to do any work on that.
So this is for illustration purposes of this.
Thank you,
Councillor Young.
So I had a couple questions. One is, what is the status of the continuation of the path northward? Is that area on the far left, to the left of the red placeholder, is that where the underpass will go through? And or I guess what state is that going to be left at?
If I might, we've retained, we've asked MMM to look at that underneath. The concept originally was, as you're all aware, was to have a walkway through the wheel. However, in addition to that, if there's a desire to have an additional connection direct here, so they are now investigating. what would be the best way? Would it be additional piles that would support that connection? Or could it be something perhaps that is cantilevered off the abutment? So that's the direction we've given, so we're just in that process now, looking to see how that could be accommodated.
To my knowledge, the head heights are more than sufficient to get through, so it's just a matter of extending that.
Thank you, Councillor Isaac. Go with Councillor Yemitz.
I think it's been pointed out that it's possible that by the time this is complete, the rest of the pathway will be there. So I think it's well worthwhile making provision now for that future expansion. The other question I had, I think, on one of the previous slides, it was the one I've asked earlier about where is the approach for bicyclists to the little overpass?
So, Councillor, I'm just wondering, maybe we should get through the presentation and come back and pick up all the questions.
That's what I was thinking we would do.
Thought it's specific. Sometimes it's nice when you got it right up there, you go, what's that red thing? But if it's bigger than that, we might want to save it for the general. Okay. Suspect it's got a few thoughts left.
So this side really is the using the rock out crops and the natural fescue meadows and the tree like park like gateway is the primary landscape character here, with multiple options for walkers and cyclists to either do on road or off road cycling or walking. So since the last plan, we have added this additional sidewalk that gets you from the intersection right onto the pedestrian walk and the bridge as well. This is a summary of the primer and surfacing treatments for both for your plaza spaces, multi-use path, sidewalks, and meetings. So your primary surface for all your plazas is a multi-unit textured and toned concrete paver, supplemented with generous edge banding rather than just a thin curb. The multi-use path is an asphalt surface, but we've upgraded the edges with a concrete band there to give it make it not look like a road and look like it blends in the park a little better. Primary sidewalk surfacings are very similar, but a scored pattern concrete. Your raised textured medians, the nosings would have a more rougher cobble-like stone edging to them. The planting summary, there's quite a diversity. There's the distinguishing between the what's more park spaces and your urban streetscapes, your medians, your planted boulevards, more natural park areas, simulating dry rock bed and rock scape plantings. And also retain as many of the existing hills as we can in the downtown intersection. So the primary, we vetted these plant types through the Parks Department, gone through a number of renditions, and they've been chosen specifically for adaptability to the changing climate that's a lot like we're having this summer. The planting areas will be irrigated as well, a supplemental irrigation, but the majority of the species have been chosen for their drought tolerance. So we're talking species like river birch, pine, black locust, madrona trees, dogwoods, gary oaks. Street trees are more traditional fastidian, or so they don't overly block visibility from driver, so they stay a little more upright. They may be in the ornamental oak and maple variety. Furnishings are quite simple but elegant. We're looking at two primary seating types, ones with backs that are freestanding and some that are more informal and sit on top of low walls. It's a hardwood IPA type wood that's durable, long lasting, and takes a lot of urban wear and tear. again, we're looking at fairly a little more streamlined, modern type fixture to complement the bridge, but also they're designed primarily because they are enduring, long lasting, and they're less, they're more resilient to changes in style over time. There's three or four wall types that we're looking at. The low feature walls, envisioning with a stone face veneer and a thick precast cap. Looking at architectural finish, low seating walls, so crisp edges, very similar to what you have in your City Hall Plaza upgrade. A lot of the natural rock groupings and rock cobble and so on is the, so those are the primary surface and texture walls. Brief summary of sustainability on the project. Obviously the primary one is encouraging cycling and walking, getting people out of their cars. Key is the locally adapted plantings and their design for drought tolerance. So that's the summary there, and I'm sure there are probably a number of questions. If I could just filter back to the slide.
Okay, so we'll go back to Jan and Isaac Gatchinoff.
The designs are restricted, the drawings are restricted to the site itself, and I still am not understanding where the bike path is coming in and what the proposed route of bicyclists coming toward the city along the that section of the bike trail where they're supposed to go.
You're talking about the E&N trail connection?
I'm talking about the existing path that runs along the north of the tennis courts by the Delta.
So through your worship, in response to the inquiry, what we're doing is handing out some maps from the CRD regarding the E&N trail and its location along as it traverses through Esquimalt into Victoria and then towards the bridge project, which it utilizes that existing rail crossing as it is today. So that's just giving an indication of where that trail is intended to be. The plans that the CRD are working on identifying the trail location. Essentially, it goes over the bridge, and as you continue westward, it works its way along the rail corridor itself, crosses Taiyi Road, and goes on to Kimta Road, parallels it, crosses Sitgum Road itself, continues to parallel that corridor, and crosses, a number of streets, Mary Russell, and eventually gets itself to Esquimalt Road. So that's the location of the recreational walkers and cyclists that would be using that E&N trail working its way to the bridge itself. And then those that are using the trail system will be able to cross it and connect with the Galvinus and either head into town over the bridge or continue northerly along the Galvinus trail, which eventually connects to the Lakeside Trail itself.
So their exact route will be? Could you just indicate what the
So this is the E&N where it merges into the overpass. And so if someone wants to get onto the bridge quickly, they go down the existing path by the delta, and they just go right on the road.
Okay, well, I've said this at every public hearing and every presentation, and I will say it once again, that is absolutely nothing. What people will do
here's one more option.
Cross the bridge.
Yeah, the other option is they go all over.
And the question is, why are you not making provision for people to do what they will all, without exception, want to do, which is cross that bridge, leave the path, and go down that slope, cross the sidewalk and onto the road?
So actually, there is one other location option. We talked about this at the last meeting, is just at this intersection ahead where the trail comes and crosses the intersection, they just simply can make a right and get on the road and get on the trail this way. That's a third option. So I think it's on the plan that Peter distributed. It shows it.
Councilor, what do you, for my elicitation, do you want to go up there and show me what the top of it?
Okay. Here's the old rail bridge. Cross, this is the old rail. The path is right beside. It runs along beside. You look down on the tennis courts. You'll be coming along the path. What you will want to do is continue to ride, crossing the road. You'll then get to here, at which point you will want to leave the path and ride down this slope to get on the road. The alternatives are the one that Mr. Cowan just suggested, which is way back here. Instead of going on a nice path, you get on the road, which carries you up a slope, so you do a lot more climbing and then down, riding beside the path. That's one option. The other option is you leave the path, and I guess it seemed to be you take a detour down here, you then wait, you cross the road, you ride along the road, you come to the intersection, you turn right and ride here. The other option is you come along here, you cross the road, go along here, you come to this intersection, you wait, you cross, come back here, you wait, you turn left. What you will want to do is come across here, leave the path, and ride down here. And I can assure you that if there is no barrier here, that is what everybody will do. There will be a path beaten into the earth within days, carrying people down the road. If you have a strong barrier here, a lot of people, I suspect, will climb over it, take their bikes over it. I will certainly move that we remove it. As soon as there's a majority of bicycle riders on council, that's what will happen. Why don't you just accept that that's what's going to happen and design for it?
Okay, if I might, if you recall, when we did go to the public sessions, the issue we heard from the public, the original plans had no sidewalk on this side. And certainly at that time, perhaps one could have looked at doing a slipstream for the bikes, although, you know, that happens now, it is a bit of a hazard where people are driving the road and the bikes come down and cut in front of them. So that was a concern. But the input we got from the public is they saw that the pedestrian movements along the south side are very important. So with that, we've now put a sidewalk in here. So that virtually makes it impossible to get anything that, because you would have the bikes crossing the sidewalk down onto the road. So there really is a safety issue there. So, I mean, I do acknowledge what Councillor Young is saying. One would hope that people will get used to those alternates. I mean, the other option is for them to simply cross and continue the multipath and go that way across the side. So it is a trade-off, and that's acknowledged. But the input we got from those public forums is that pedestrian connection was certainly quite important.
So question, I can't say this, but how easy is it to come off the ENA trail, go across that bridge and join the lake?
Well, this will be
what happens, right? Keep going to right there. What happens to the
book? Well, this is just a continuation. This will be at grade, and you'll simply cycle over and cycle this. So it'll be a very smooth connection. In fact, if you look at the perspectives, I think it does show one of the perspectives, maybe just where it shows the overpass, just the perspective of the overpass.
That's all good room for people going north and
south. Well, but then I guess that certainly is the issue then of trying to put in the, if you go back, the elephant's foot connection to allow bikes to cross. So on the other side, the bikes, if coming this way, is then they use this crossing to disperse whichever way.
I suggest the elephant's foot crossing should be on the sidewalk to where people walking bicycles when you cross it.
Yeah, Your Worship, we vetted this through the site group, and they've given us their advice on note also is when you're coming off that top of the ENN trail, what happens is that you're between the difference between this point right here and the road below it, there's at least 5.5 meter drop. So that's the difference in elevation. So then you have to get around, it's basically ramping the cyclist down towards the road. And there's always safety concerns about you're coming down at high speed towards the road, jumping onto the, crossing the sidewalk over the curb onto the roadway itself and trying to merge with those commuter cyclists that are on the road itself. It's just a combination of those elements. We just feel it's best to have the crossing where it's shown on the plan today, and it seems comfortable. And we'll make sure there's provisions to allow that, to make sure that it's not inviting for those to want to go in that direction through strategic plantings and then appropriate treatments to prevent that concern from occurring.
Well, that railing would also be continuous off of the overpass bridge. So it is essentially a control.
So there's what Ken is, Mr. Ward, say there's a railing on both sides here and also on that bridge. So there's continuous railing essentially through there that would basically prohibit that from occurring.
Thank you. So I have Isaac Gudgeon also.
Right.
Couple
of clicker thing.
You never give the microphone to somebody in the audience.
I found Councillor Young's argument to be quite persuasive and a related aspect. So, leaving that issue aside, I think a lot of the employment in the downtown is to the south. And I do have concerns that if the logic is we want them on a separated bike path, we will be dropping people off. It's now two blocks north of where they want to be going. If they were the legislature, or the finance ministry, or education, or the whole range of private and public sector employers who live in the central and southern part of downtown, there's relatively little employment up here, numerically speaking. Any of the recreational riders who want to go from the ENN or the Goose and eventually tie into Dallas Road and the southerly reaches of the city, or residents for that matter, going to those two CRD trails. So I think there will be a strong desire to leave the trail network and use this whole curved access. So I think it speaks to the issue of a cycle pedestrian priority bridge or a car priority bridge. And I think we are looking at a car priority bridge with very generous pedestrian and cycling amenities. At this stage in the game, it's a question if we can shift that balance. I personally would favor building that pedestrian and cycle priority bridge and the motorists to be in the back seat for once, so to say. One other question, will we include the rendition of the plaza on the east side? But assuming that no changes are made and that there's no walkway under the bridge at this point, what happens here? Is it kind of just a dead end that's at a different grade than the surface of the bridge?
Yes, you're at an elevation that is at or just above the existing parking path. So you're probably about 12, 13 feet below the road elevation.
And below the pathway, the sidewalk is hanging off that side of the bridge?
No, that sidewalk meets right there.
So it ties in.
So that's why that elevation is chosen. So you come off the pedestrian. You hit level ground.
So it won't just be a dead end.
No. It's a continuous path that gets you right up into this downtown.
Now, is there any other sidewalk pedestrian access to cross the bridge, or is that the only?
There's another sidewalk is the multi-use path that's on the north side. That's the 5 meter walkway itself. So on both sides of the bridge, you have pedestrian amenities.
My one concern, I guess, would be for accessibility. I have a friend who's in a wheelchair, and I know that any grade, even grade that meets highway standards, is very challenging.
Yeah.
So I guess I would have some concerns if the only way for people to travel that grade would be in competition with bikes that are high-speed, non-motorized vehicles.
Well, I think the south path is pedestrian only, and it's grade accessible.
Except it does have a considerable climb, doesn't it?
Well, it's a very gentle slope when you look at the extent of the length.
Yes. Yeah, so you're correct in the fact that there's a drop at the road where the bridge meets right there.
Right.
But that road stays level, but your path is rising. So you're gently rising up into that downtown.
My last point is, I think it makes a lot of sense, as Councilor Young said, to build the connection under the bridge at this time. It just seems that to open that up again, waiting for a private, there's three or four potential private parties, and they may or may not be the same party. Well, it's been disclosed publicly, but the fact is that those three projects, three or more projects, are going to move at different paces. I mean, it makes sense for the city to provide the infrastructure in place when it's spending $93 million or more on that part of downtown. So I would strongly support building right up to the city's property boundaries with our own path. Even if we're thinking having to put barriers and rails to keep people from falling from water, that would be infrastructure that would have to be removed to put a future cantilever and pylon behind it. And I think we're more likely to get the best treatment and the most sympathetic tie-in if it's done in concert rather than if it's done for
long. Thank you. The next speaker is Gretchen Nadalgo. Good passing, Colpo, Mitchell.
Just a couple of specific questions. So let me just confirm what I think I heard you say to Councilor Lyon's question. All the grades and all the pathways are wheelchair accessible and meet appropriate standards.
That's right.
All of the pathways and all of the grades meet all the accessibility standards.
Yes.
All accessible to a wheelchair and the mobility device.
Yes.
Yes. Is that also true for all the services? I noticed your services, some of them are lovely, but a bit lovely.
Well, the multi-use path is, it's asphalt. The actual plaza spaces are a common unit paver similar to what you have on your sidewalks now. It's a deck of paver essentially. The rougher surface are really in the areas that people aren't going to be walking across the lawn.
Okay. And when you look at your seating, I love your benches. Are they going to look just like that? My question is, are they going to have dividers in them, or are they actually going to be benches?
Yes, they're freestanding. There's freestanding ones that are essentially 8 feet long on the backs. You can get them with arms or not.
And there's no dividers?
Dividers.
There's no dividers, just great seats.
Oh, you mean for people who might sleep on them?
Right.
Or skateboarding. Well, skateboarding is easy. The sleeping, yes, you can get arms.
I don't want arms.
Oh.
That's my point.
Oh.
My point is that I love the way they look.
Yeah.
And I like the fact that they don't have arms.
Yeah.
Just confirming that they don't.
Oh, right now they don't.
Great. And the same type of thing, we've been drinking on with the great bottle. Is there also possible for there to get tap on the room?
Yes, those ones come with, you can get the three,
right.
Or the two.
People can fill water bottles.
Yeah, and I've seen that quite, it's a lot more common now.
It's very common, yeah. And it's a real asset, I think, to the community use of the space. So
the picture we showed in there has that.
Yeah. And my last question, you referenced earlier the proposal that's still working its way through the process around the agenda. Does the picture that you have presented, can it be built exactly as you presented, regardless of what might happen with the road in terms of proposing?
Right now, this plan here is built exactly to meet the edges of what currently exists there now.
Right.
So essentially, we this edge right here, we actually have to slope up to meet that elevation, and so we. We clustered plantings and rocks and sort of rock edge treatment to just make it look a little more interesting even in the intro. So essentially it's all going to be planted and or green to meet those edges.
Well, I guess my question then, if I'm not making it clear, should the Northern Jump proposal proceed as it is currently proposed, what would have to change?
Through your worship, the plan has, is identified that they matches existing conditions and would be compatible with, to meet future needs if and such if that area were to redevelop. So
this could happen.
We're saying this could happen with the existing conditions today, and if there development were to be considered or could occur, we would ensure that it's compatible with the future plans on what would take place or would take place.
Thanks.
Joe, fourth.
Yeah, we just as a side comment, we removed permanent wall fixtures for that probability.
Thank you. My question is actually sort of pick up on where Councilor Alfold's question for, and that is the issue. Has it been looked at elements of septic? And as someone who's been a councilor from downtown, I look at each one and I think, okay, tag there. Bikes will love riding down this part, doing the tricks, the skateboards will slide along this rail. Is there staff that look at that through the residents?
So I want to make sure that is in people's minds. For me,
I recognize that the biggest conflict that we always have is not between cars and pedestrians and bikes. Our biggest conflict is bikes and pedestrians. And respectfully, and I understand what a couple of our counselors are suggesting, but I think the realization that we've heard from many people is there's a commuter cyclist, and frankly, we want to get the commuter cyclists off these trails. That is not the intention. So the people who are really trying to, you think they're going to grab their bike, drop it down 5.5 meters just so they can quickly get onto the next thing, they're going to be on the road before that, recognizing that. And that's a good thing. We've heard often on the Gallagher Bruce Trail is that you have the commuter cyclists who are a problem for the kids who are out there just riding their bikes to the people who are walking. And this you have completely separate. My expectation is that you're going to have the recreational cyclists and walkers on the E&N Trail, that they'll be quite fine with doing some of this. The commuter cyclists will be on the road going like crazy, knowing that that's the easiest way to jump right. I also recognize that we have a 30-year plan here for official community plan, and we also are building a bridge for 100 years. And so recognizing that maybe a lot more people want to go south today, I think that as we build out in the north end of the town, which we are seeing, that more and more people will want to be going into the north end. So I want to deny not only what I think people are going to do today, but what they're going to do in the future. So I do understand what Councillor Young and Councillor Oz is saying, but I think that if we actually put that in, we are going to have the loudest public outcry, because we're going to have all the bike people going right into the people on the sidewalks. And so I think it isn't about cars versus bike pedestrians. It's about saying, who do we need to keep safe? And frankly, I think it makes more sense to recognize that the pedestrians are most important, especially from that side, recognizing where our population is going. I think the design as is, obviously there's tweaking that needs to go, but I think if I'm asked to make a decision, I'm going to have to err on protecting the pedestrians from the cyclists on the sidewalks. I just want to add those two pieces, recognizing. I guess the final one is looking at those plazas, and the two thoughts that came to mind is they cried out for public art, and I know that that's another piece of the project somewhere else, but really looking, the first thing went, wow, you want to put a big piece of public art there. The other key thought is, and it may serve both pieces, or at least a small piece, is I recognize those rock outcrops are really exciting. But again, back to the urban cyclists, they love rocks to hop up and down on. And I've seen them out here, just out here in Chinatown, off and up and down the whole mountain thing. So we might have to think about where do we buy them off, for lack of a better term. I also want to put a really big rock in the middle of those plazas so they bounce up and down on top of it, as opposed to getting into the rocks that we put into the seated area in the wall out there. So that's something we need to at least have an eye to as we move forward, recognizing that there's going to be a bunch of young people who I know there's probably much more effective in term than hopping their bikes up on street furniture and up on rocks, but there's probably no end to it. I don't know what it's called, but anyway, so I think that's something I don't have in mind to do before. Councillor Gudgeon and then Councillor Madoff.
I just wanted to clarify on the second to last page with the median, which is there, or I guess the median, the left hand turn signal.
Stone.
Texture, It's just, it's a minor detail, but it isn't, you know what I mean? If there's the budget, that's not a lot of money, but it adds detail if it's just done properly rather than just texturing.
No, fair comment. Keep that in mind.
Thank you. I trust in this being obtained.
Thank you, Bridget. Bridget, back to the issue of accessibility. You said it's a gentle grade. I'd love some more understanding of what that actually means. Between, in the past, when we've done analyses on recreation, we said it's a 5-minute walk, and it turns out it's a 5-minute walk for an 8-year-old, 25-year-old, as opposed to the full range. So when we say we thought about wheelchairs, all range of wheelchairs, and is it a gentle grade for an 80-year-old pushing his or her spouse? Just trying to understand that.
Currently, the grade is under 8%, which is considered disabled or a wheelchair ramp elevation.
And again, quite often those wheelchair ramps are done with the greatest possible respect using the analysis of our rehousing. And I'm trying to make sure the full range of people with disabilities.
Well, I mean, all wheelchair ramps that are called wheelchair ramps are to the same code standard, so I don't know which ones you might have been on, but they are maximum 3% grade elevation. But you currently do have roads and sidewalks that don't do well. We see that as probably the 12-15% range in a lot of the near city roads. Down here, we don't have anything reaching that. And currently, you have pathways on the other side of the bridge that are well in excess of 15-20% straight down the embankments that would not be current.
So pathways up here. The old railway standard was 4% grade or less. So
yeah,
just so we understand.
Yeah, it's under 8%, but there's nothing exceeding
that. Okay, thank you. The second one for the treatment of the student counselor Young's concern about cycling access. The treatment of the Raymond treatment you talked about on the big west side, the bird's eye view map. Yes, that one. You said there was railing across the bridge. How does that wrap around? What's the railing treatment? Does it, because it does, I concur with Jeff that there is a concern that if you don't treat that properly, then you will get some folks who think it a challenge to do the 5-meter drop and come in the path that we hadn't. So do we have some thoughts around?
Yeah, the thought would be that it's a continuous rail from the red dot to the existing rail overpass. So that the pedestrian overpass railing would connect to the existing structure to prevent people from going straight through and down the hill.
Thank you. A point of information, Your Worship. People keep referring to this 5-meter drop, yet from the bridge, I see the railway, typically almost level, continuing to the bridge. Now, in fact, wouldn't it be more accurate to say that it's not a 5-meter drop, it's continuing on more or less level as the road rises to meet you, which is the temptation that will be presented to science. Is that road, as it approaches the bridge, not rising?
Oh, absolutely. The road is rising. The reference to the 5.5 meters is underneath that pathway. That's a 5.5 meter clearance between the road and the bottom of the path.
But the point is that people coming and going around that corner where we're proposing to put our 5-meter barbed wire barrier to keep people from going through is, in fact, you're not faced with going back down to the road. You're faced with, shall I just continue on the same grade that I'm continuing on, the essentially the railway grade, until the road rises up to meet me, as opposed to descending that 5 meters and then climbing back up that 5 meters after I've crossed the road, waited at the intersection, turned right.
No, you're certainly right. When one looks at the elevation here and the elevation here, they're both the same. This does go down and up. And that's actually the sidewalk along the road is going to have to come up to the bridge.
Thank you, Your Worship. And I wasn't trying to open up a discussion about what the actual height is, but just that we should recognize that there is an issue there that I think needs to be addressed. So the final comment I have was still on that map. That's, as you've got it identified, the new park, which is under number three there. What's the treatment on the south end of the highlighted section facing that park? Well, I see some planting, but what I want to make sure is we actually take into account the future use of the park as we do treatment on the south edge of it.
The finished treatment for this project will be a seeded grass slope, a 3-to-1 slope to the existing path down, and that will allow sort of maximum flexibility for future park design in that area. And it was that was the elevation given to us as front parts as well. So yes, the line that you're seeing between the dark green and the light green is what's planted versus what is just going to be left as a seed.
Thank you, Rachel.
Thank you, Councilman.
Thank you. If we look at the information we have on the downtown side and the plaza which narrows into the pathway along the west side of 4th Street, perhaps through the chair to Mr. Kalinchuk, what is the city's commitment beyond the end of the paved area that we see there in terms of the sidewalk?
So I'm sorry, are we talking about here?
No. Along Wharf Street?
Along
south, no, south along Wharf Street where the path ends at the foot of Johnson.
Oh, I'm sorry, right here?
Yes.
Yes, I believe this gets tied to an existing sidewalk, is it not? Yes, so this ties into the existing sidewalk that's up there today.
But there'll be a dramatic change in material, and I'm assuming it'll go from the regular sidewalk to the new treatment?
Correct. There'll be a transition area. They'll have to make sure that it's fairly smooth for that, yes.
Just in terms of general comments, I think today the intention was that we would get a better understanding of the look and feel and the flavor of the project. And it's hard to see whether it's a preliminary stage or a mid-stage. I suppose following up on Councillor Thornton Joe's comments, I certainly see the improvements from a pedestrian and a cycling point of view and access and all of those things. But you know, what I'm not seeing is, I think, as Councillor Thornton Joe characterized it, is the creativity and the imagination, which is not to look like Disneyland, but I just see it as being very antiseptic. It's nice materials and all those kind of things, but you know, this is the creation of a new public realm for the city. And I just don't know where that kind of development is going to take place as these plans are further developed. I think what would have been really helpful, because you know, for me, I can't go forward today saying that I have confidence in what this is going to look like. And perhaps that's going to be the result of more design development. What would have been really, really helpful would have been even just one or two renderings, just showing a cross-section of what it's like as a pedestrian going through any particular zone there so we could really absorb what the atmosphere was going to be like there. And without that, it's really hard because we're looking at all these pictures of colored places and how certain elements have been used. But I can't go away today saying, you know, I'm really fine beginning to get sense of what that experience is going to be like. So what I'm wondering at this point is where we go from here, what we're going to see next, and where we're going to see it, so that we're confident not only with the connections, and that's something that really is helpful when we've got cross sections as well, to understand where you go as a pedestrian, how you experience, where you go as a cyclist, and how you experience. And I still think that's a piece that we still need. But just in terms of where this goes, it talks about ongoing updates with the general public and community associations. But I'm wondering, what is the next step? How are we going to begin to be more informed of what it's actually going to feel like and what the human experience would be like in this area?
Well, you know, I guess certainly when one looks at the overall project, you know, we are mindful of the budget. We're being very mindful here to say this is a landscaping we're putting in that can grow on in the future. And that's really when one looks at the plaza areas, I think the opportunity that you've indicated about having more fun and more things are items that can be added later to try and animate that space. And I think that was what we heard from the public, certainly through the public forums, but we want to see more animation of that space. Certainly the budget is a big issue with us. These plans now are being made available to the proponents because the October 18th date is coming fairly close, so they have an idea of this. Now, these are not the construction plans that yet has to be prepared, so there's an opportunity as we get the further details, the location of the trees and that sort of thing can be done. We certainly do understand what you're saying with regards to kind of the renderings. What we try to do within the public realm document is have people have a feel of what the space would be like. We're trying to reflect, in a sense, what people came back with. They really want to see the natural outcrops, the connections. And I really think that the opportunity is in the future to build when there's other funding available to animate those spaces. It certainly would have been nice to have that all wrapped in now, but the focus is, you know, under the charter, it says to come under the budget. So that's certainly what is a key focus for us in the office. And, it, you know, the landscaping was a tough one. I know Ken's worked on this project for a number of years and had many iterations of the landscaping that certainly was a lot more substantial to a point where we feel we're comfortable that we're within the budget, but we're still able to kind of meet the national realm. So I'm mindful of the comments, and certainly something we'll continue to dialogue and look for opportunities, maybe even working with other opportunities to animate the space as best as we can, because it's certainly, you know, you don't want to build a beautiful structure and have both ends not meet the same level. So, you know, things such as the banners, as you've indicated, and making sure that the island treatments are not just plain concrete, but it does have some visual appeal to it. So we'll continue to keep you informed as we go through the selection of the proponents. We'll be reviewing what they have, and ultimately, as we move forward, you know, hopefully we'll get the details and try and keep you informed.
So just to be a little more explicit, are we going to be seeing things before the construction drawings begin to be prepared?
What will happen now is the construction drawings will come forward, which will take the details. We did give you the architectural set, which was quite large, and that's where it does give the details, the materials. There's enough in there for the proponents to look at and be able to provide their pricing and make sure it's within the budget, so it gives them a feel. And, you know, as we develop the construction set, certainly we can provide that to council. There's certainly no issue with that or any of the components of the bridge. So we'll certainly make sure that these components, knowing that you're interested in them, that we get that to you.
Well, I think it's useful. I mean, I don't know that it's useful to have them, because by that point it's too late. The construction drawings are done. I'm just a bit surprised, because in my experience, even on design panel, there would have been more material being available to give you a real sense of things. And, you know, not to be disrespectful, I had a lot of trouble getting excited about this image. And this is, you know, such an exciting opportunity, and maybe it's going to be so much more than we could ever imagine based on what we're seeing here. I would just have liked to have something beyond the basics that would really give us a sense of what that environment would be like. Maybe it's because people don't draw anymore, and everything's reduced to CAD drawings, which doesn't do them justice. But I would really think, especially in the landscape firm, have somebody who's able to just give you that drawing that shows this is what your experience is going to be like. This is, you know, so antiseptic and so cold, and probably doesn't do justice to the work that you've done either, which is very unfair, because I feel like I may be being you know, critical in an unwarranted way, because this is what we've got. It's like getting the floor plan of the interior of a building if you don't know what the outside looks like. And so I'm just reluctant that the next stage will be to show us what the construction drawings are. Sense is that staff are mindful of the comments that we've made. I'm not looking for that infilling of value added that may come later. I'm just looking for a setting a tone and a framework that lends itself to that as the landscape grows up and those kinds of things as well. So it just gives me some pause, because I just don't feel like I can really go out and people ask me, what's my experience going to be like? I don't feel like I have the information to do that with confidence at this point. And I'm really pleased to hear what the input has been from the public, the Recycling Coalition, and all that. It would be useful to have that, you know, debriefed to us in some way, perhaps a more
all would benefit from having that kind of confidence in what the space is going to be like as well. So I don't think I can really do more than express those thoughts and concerns. I think the principles that have been brought to it are, you know, absolutely right. It's just getting a sense now, what do those principles deliver? And I still see a gap there.
Thank you. Saw Councillor Gudgeon's hand, and then Councillor comes up. Okay, Council will go around again. Councillor Gudgeon, Councillor House, Councillor Isaac. Yes, no. Councillor Gudgeon, Councillor House, Councillor Isaac.
I certainly understand Councillor Maddow's concerns, but I do want to congratulate staff for what I see in these drawings is that you really did listen to what I heard at the public meetings as well, which is the walkability of it and from the residents of Big West. What I see this being, perhaps naively, and I hope that future councils don't look back and say, oh no, we're not putting any more money in that area, is a nice canvas that can be added to in the future as money permits with the public art components and et cetera, et cetera. So I think it's got lots of potential of where it can go. I hope, I would love to see it go there further, sooner than later, but I think that, you know, maybe it'll be a few years down the road when we can add all those wonderful pieces. But I just want to congratulate, I think a lot of the concerns that I've heard have been addressed. Thank you,
Councillor Helps.
Yeah, I haven't spoken on the issue and I wasn't going to, except I really do want to inject a little bit of positivity in here, because I think we can look at all the drawings in the world and people can say, what's my experience going to be? Your experience is going to be what you make it. We have this beautiful space and it's people that will make it come alive. A drawing, no matter how nice it is, isn't going to make it come alive. And I can see in my mind's eye, just the canvas that's there, as Councillor Gudgeon said, there's a whole lot of life that's going to happen there. So I would just like to echo Councillor Gudgeon. I've been to both of the public sessions. The input's been considered. We have some really boring drawings, but drawings are just drawings. Let's just build this and see what life happens in that space. And I think that that's, I'd like to move on from the conversation. I just wanted to inject that into it.
Thank you, Councillor Isaac.
This is just an aside. I think it's, I don't want to see the scope of the project change, but I'd like council to have an open mind about this particular parcel down the road, because I guess some sight lines have to be there for cars merging, but I think we could do a lot more, potentially maybe even a sunken skateboard park or planting of potatoes. So I think that would be a distinct parks project. I think the grassy lot for now is fine, but that land is being orphaned by the roads. There could be more playground. So I think doing that as an asset down the road that could be a lot more than a lot. If we go to the rendition of the other side of the bridge, I think there's one technical problem. If this is a future park and we're going to spend several million parks money distinct from this project designing this, the problem is there's no way to get to it from either the ENN or the Gallery Goose. And the only way to access this would either be from the downtown side on the sidewalk, or by walking under Harbor Road and back up into this. So that's going to be a huge problem. There's a continuous rail here. There's going to be people who want to come over from Dockside who probably would rather stay up at Parade and not have to go grapple with this new stop lane intersection. So I think we need to reconsider. I think the ideal would be a pathway that would stay at Parade, could tie in here to the lanes if necessary to avoid the problem of the pedestrian cycle interface. That would allow even Dockside residents and others to follow the path to get into the downtown sidewalk, to have an interaction with what's happening in this area. So I think we need a way for people to go, even from the ENN, to get into the new city park if they're walking from that way or from the Dockside. We can't have an impenetrable barrier, or this park won't be utilized to its full extent.
Big magnets to attract any bicycle.
So I think one further tie-in for so many reasons would be advisable, even if there's some costs.
Well, if I might, a couple of things. First of all, we are protecting this for the rail corridor, so we're trying to minimize any development in that area, so that doesn't have to be removed in the future. There are going to be sidewalks along the road. There are sidewalks that come through here. So there's other connections. It depends, I guess, on the use of that park. One would assume that when we get to the process of evaluating the park, I think the connectivity could be looked at, and maybe at that time, as one develops, you know, there may be some changes that would be. It's hard to judge. For example, if it's an amphitheater, you know, maybe that's not wanted up there. So it again, I think it depends on how the programming of that site and the planning goes. So, you know, we're trying to be as open-minded as possible to try not to have things that have to be removed or duplicated. So, but it is an important comment.
Yes, I mean, it was protecting the railroad corridor, and there was expression earlier that we don't build on it and do all those things because then when you want to put the railroad in later, people would say, well, wait a minute, you're interfering with my park or you're interfering with my sidewalk. So I also recognize that it may look big up here, but as someone who runs that every second day, there ain't a lot of difference there. I mean, really, if you're at that corner, if you could just drop down where it says the Delta Hotel parking lot, that piece there, like it's a really easy area to access in there. So before you start talking about spending a couple extra $1 million, you recognize you're talking an extra 10 or 15 feet. So that's part of it. But I want to, and so I'm also in the middle, frankly, between both. I can show you some absolutely amazing drawings of architectural space, 3/4 of a block away, and it's absolutely dead. It's a dead big hole because it just wasn't designed right. That just the building is just up there on the other side of the parking lot in the Royal Bank. And until this block here starts to go, you have a bad. So just because you have a plan and just because you think people are going to go there, you actually have to have a space that people want to go to. So you know, don't just say, well, we'll get the animation later. You know, frankly, we're going to be cutting the budget on whether we actually provide animation in our square. Right? So those are issues that we're going to have to consider. So I don't want to easily dismiss Councillor Battle's concerns. You have to be concerned that while we design something that's going to draw people. Having said that, at the same time, yeah, I'm quite excited about many elements of this. I love the rock outcropping that I was talking about. It was sort of having a reflection of Meeting Hill Park for me. A lot of what happens there on that slope with those the rocks and all those other things. So we want to make sure we get it right. But we also recognize that it's organic. Sorry. And we look forward to it. So thank you. Thank you very much. The last thing I want to do, I want to make sure. So we have an opportunity for Big West to feed in. We have an opportunity for the downtown residents to feed in. Where can just anybody else feed in, including councilors? Is it linked on the Johnson Street Bridge website? Is there an opportunity for people to continue to feed information in?
I believe your worship through the website certainly is continuing updated information provided there, and I also providing through the website.
So at some point soon, this will be up on the.
Oh yes.
Our thing.
Yes.
We can do that. Oh, thank you very much. Appreciate that. Motion to receive. Someone did it. All in favor? Opposed? Carried. Thank you. 2013 permissive tax exemptions. Oh, I'm sorry. Actually, Council, we at this time have indicated that we wanted to go. Did we hear for tax?
Yeah, this is Laura. Why don't we continue and we'll camera right before the end?
Done. Okay. Thank you. Permissive tax exemptions. From Christopher Payne, manager of revenue. I'm not sure we should actually ever have that.
Just on a point of order,
Worship, I have to indicate that on item four on the recommendations to adopt the bylaw, that includes, I think, all the exemptions, which include Beacon Community Services, why it was employed. So I would like in the discussion or the motion about that, item four to be dealt with separately, or?
Councilor Thornton, Joe, you sometimes have a problem with the, I don't know if the commission consent is already here for the conversation. Mr. Willis?
Your worship, you won't actually be adopting any bylaw today. Mr. Payne has provided a draft bylaw to you, which contains all the information that would go forward to council at a council meeting, likely October 11th, and then for adoption on the 25th. So it's provided for information today, so you understand what each of the individual exemptions are and the amounts.
So thank you. Although I'll leave the individuals as to whether you can get in there, but you will, we'll all have reference to Councilor's and others' comfort. Yeah, being recommended, you still forward is probably. Okay, thank you. With that, let us go with the speaking order I had. First hand I saw was Charlie Thornton.
Thank you very much, and I just have some questions about one of the ones on our list, and that's the Bayonne Cultural Center. And I know we received a letter as a late item, and first day I'd just like to acknowledge that we do have two representatives for the Bayonne Center. So we have Gladden Pierce and Norman Dewey here to answer any questions if anyone had any. I guess my question, service. Of course, when you're doing a new applicant or adding to it, of course, they have to lay out everything that they do with the center. But I wouldn't mind having an example of what other centers are comparable to what would be proposed here, because I'm sort of looking at it in a vacuum of knowing in comparison to, for example, I understand the name of the Da Vinci Center, which does this and gets this percentage, or the Norwood House, which gets this percentage of offers this. So I guess that's my concern, because I think in the letter they mentioned that some of the activities that we that may be deemed as not considered as part of the recommendation, is they would argue that it is. So I don't know if we can have a little more discussion on this one in particular.
It's actually very unusual for the city to provide a partial exemption, except for those exemptions that only get 50%. Now, the reason that that this property was originally given a 60% exemption was because it was given an exemption under the place of worship bylaw. And they only exempted the portion of the property council at that time that they considered was being used for place of worship. So that area of the community center, as I understand, is still being used for place of worship services. The question about this organization was that they wanted to expand the level of exemption to 100% based on the other services that were also privately provided at the community center. Yeah. And one other point I would make is that the arts and culture exemption category has been used to provide a full exemption to other properties in the past, but only the museums, art centers, and theaters. So that's what makes this application a bit more unusual than other arts and culture exemptions.
So are other cultural centers, do any of them get 100%?
Yes, they all do get 100%.
Sorry?
Yes, they do get 100%. So if you qualify under the arts and culture exemption in the policy, you get a full 100% exemption.
Okay, so are there any, so the Da Vinci Hall, the Norwood, the Ukrainian Hall, and arts and crafts and dance, do any of them get 100%?
Not that I'm aware of, no. So
some examples would be the Bellevue Theater Society, the Craig Derrick Castle Museum Society. I'm having trouble thinking of other examples right now.
That's all I'm asking.
Thank you. Next speaker is Alex Eisenhower.
I appreciate that we're in the middle of a policy review. I wonder what would be the implication if we didn't approve this today? Because I don't want to get into line item by line item, because I'm sure we all have different ideas about what could go where and what should get exempted and what shouldn't, and I realize that's the job of policy. But I do have a couple of issues just with some of the things that were brought to our attention in this report. So St. Andrew's School, Glenline, Norfolk, the Bioindian Cultural Center, and the Fernwood Energy Housing. So those four issues stand out for me and could be, you know, we can adjust some things within what's been pulled out, but I don't want to know what you're looking for today.
We're looking for the approval of these recommendations today.
Today is line by line. In the absence of policy, line by line.
The bylaws, unfortunately, have to be adopted. So this set by today, then, or could have a special council meeting, but the bylaws do need the two meetings of council in order to approve.
Okay, so that's helpful. So what, and I've got three pens scribbled all over all of the pages of this report, because we had a long conversation last Friday about the importance of affordable housing and that's a priority, and then we have a group here that asks for an exemption for their affordable housing, and we turn it down for good reason, because it's not in the policy. But then we have a private school that's getting the 100% exemption that's being knocked down to 93.5 because of the consolidation of their lot. So within what's being pulled out, I would propose that we say yes to Fernwood Energy and 100% to Bioindian and take the money somehow from St. Andrews and or Glen Lyon. Sorry, I'm allowed to speak my mind at this table. I think that's why we're here. So that's
the idea. Sorry, you said you had a lot of green ones? Go for the green ones.
That's it. I just wanted to say those things.
Thank you, Councilor Ed.
I've got similar reviews. I think it's unfortunate that the review wasn't complete in time for today, because there are some real savings or relieving the tax burden on taxpaying residents or capturing new revenue for the next tax year. So for the fact that we don't have the review today, I think it says clearly in the report the city's current policy only provides 50% exemptions to educational facilities. I think we should follow that current policy, the 2013 exemptions, and so that would apply to the private schools, including the bioregional school. So I would favor that. I also have a so I think rather than 93%, 50% for Glen Lyon. And if that means there's savings that could be apportioned to the term of NRG or whether the council should
not. So I'm probably going to ask for help, given how we want. Yeah. I would ask to either ask questions of staff and put motions on the table.
I'll throw a motion on the table that we approve recommendations 5 and 6. Just to get the ball rolling.
Sure. I want to do that while we're looking for Councilor.
I'll have to figure out maybe we'll deal with the maybe some things that maybe have a consensus on.
Motion for 5 and 6 has been put on the table. All those in favor?
Oh, sorry.
For the motion. Thank you. Speaking to the motion, I have Nav and Alto.
Through your worship to staff, to begin with, we don't have a policy on affordable housing. So number one, how would we determine whether or not this is affordable housing? And what could the potential implication be in terms of exemptions in the future within that whole spectrum of what might be considered affordable housing in the city?
Are you referring to 5 and 6?
Mm-hmm. Well, 5 and 6.
I think these are two properties that council had. These are ones that council had.
No, I was actually going back to the whole notion of affordable housing period and being back to the Fernwood Energy as well.
That's done.
It's a different one.
The affordable housing in general.
Sorry, can I interrupt? I'm trying to focus
to. The current motion before the table is specifically that tax exemption application for Greater Victoria Housing Society for 2014 Government Street and for 21 Gorge Road be approved. They are the only two that are speaking on the table. Everything else will come later.
Exceptions made. The policy was amended for these specific projects, and they would be given 10-year exemptions. It was for, I believe, buildings that were going to be affordable housing that were going to be to encourage them during the economic downturn. Very strict timelines on them. There was two. That these two properties fit those. So these are. This is a very much an exception. And there were 10 years period, and then that'll be it. So, but for all of the other ones, they're all annual, 1 year.
So just for 5 and 6 then, what we're looking at is a proposal to leave the voluntary taxes for 10 years, and you give it the approximate value. And so these, if we approve this today, these would not have the new rules of tax exemption policy applied.
That's correct. It was a very specific change to the policy to deal with these projects. That was done.
So that's better. Anyone else who wishes to speak directly on to the items known as 2014 Government Street and 21 Gorge Road? Hearing none, all in favor? Opposed? None opposed? Carried.
Just one question for staff, and then I'll hand it over to others to make motions. I know the Anglican Diocese has been in the real estate business lately, particularly controversial properties in Oakland. Did they pay any taxes on parcels on Ryan Street in 2012?
Just want to have a look at that bylaw for a moment.
And the relevance is, I personally question whether any exemption should be provided to the parcel. St. Andrew's School site, which has an active development proposal that we're hearing from residents, and if they're going to be making a fairly large windfall for this property that's been exempt for decades, I personally don't favor an exemption for that one. I don't think
they're going to
reimburse it. But are they? I'm curious. Right now, the parcel of Ryan is privately held, and I wonder, did that owner pay any taxes when the property was conveyed? I feel it would be no if an exemption was approved.
To my knowledge, they didn't pay any property taxes last year, although I see they're not in an exemption by law for this for 2013. Sorry, when I say last year, I mean 2012 property taxes. Now, when an exemption is provided, it's provided for the entire year. So if it's sold to a private owner halfway through the year, they're still exempted the entire year. So if during that conveyance last year, the private owner would have been exempt from taxes. Now that they're not in the bylaw, they will be protected.
So the issue is that property changed hands in March or April. So we exempted it for 3/4 of the year. That private owner is going to be making a similar windfall by converting it to 4 or 5 residential lots, paying no taxes. So just to flag that I think we should give strong consideration to no exemption for the St. Andrew's School site.
So
because it's in the consolidated, so we then move the entire list and go
individual by individual.
But we have 989 parts.
And we will do, if you have an issue with that one, we'll bring it up with a motion, then we'll move on.
Okay, sure. So that,
so what page number?
I don't have the folio number, but it's the Bishop, I believe it's 10,000, the page, I don't know, page 50 of 65. Two parcels listed under the Bishop of Victoria, 1002 and 1012 Pandora Avenue, that we pull those two items from the list of exempt properties.
Point of order, Your Worship. If I may, we have the ADA, are we really going to go line by line through this? I think we should just address the issues that are pulled out for our attention and report.
I'm sorry, if I may say, I do hear your point of order. Perhaps I can explain. The goal here, as indicated, is if you have any issues with any one of these, pull it up, let's discuss it, do a motion. At the end, we can move a motion for the last remaining nobody here. But we're trying to get to the points.
Okay. Again, I need clarification. We have an agenda item with specific things. We also have the backup bill. I thought we were dealing with specific stresses that were providing to us that we were not going to go through all of these. Yeah. I agree with
that. Today is the last time for people to correctly address anything within staff. The report, all of what is different from every each year, that does not preclude any counselor from questioning. Should we keep doing the status quo? And this is the only time the council is going to be able to do it.
Well,
so if someone has an issue with landline, or someone has an issue with this, is the only time they can do it.
Well, with respect, Your Worship, it might make for a more orderly meeting if we could deal with the ones that have been pulled out, get those done, and if anybody else has issues with any of the other ones, then we would deal with them. But there's grab bag all over the place is going to keep us here all afternoon with no result. So could we just please deal with those, and then that doesn't close the opportunity for others to bring up any of the other exceptions as well.
I'll withdraw it this time. Thank you. Well, then we will do that, and we will get to a certain specific. So the first one is to deal with then the recommendation one, that the permissive tax exemption for the Fernwood Neighborhood Resource Group Society be declined. That is the recommendation by staff. The recommendation is we are speaking to the recommendation, Councilor Mallon.
Thank you. The reason that I would support the recommendation is that in terms of the construction date of this project, the program that we're looking at began in 2009, and this was not as a result of that program that this project was constructed by the call. So if that's correct, if we did support this, we'd be opening up to anything pre-2009, for example, wanted to make the case on affordable housing, which was the intent of the opportunity was to encourage the construction of, it wasn't to offer tax relief for existing projects. That's what I was
wondering. Thank you. Also, good.
My question was going to be, why is it one different than 5 and 6? But if I understood your comment correctly, it's different by virtue of the fact that 5 and 6 are the permissive tax exemptions to encourage their redevelopment, their new units. Whereas one has existed for some years and has not coming forward with an application for a tax exemption on existing tax owners. Is that correct?
That's correct. There's very strict timelines and then details in terms of who could apply for a tax exemption. It was a very short time back in new units. In terms of opening up the policy to allow affordable exemptions for affordable housing, that would be opening the door. Our tax base could not afford to provide tax exemptions to all affordable housing.
I'm just going to, I don't know if it's doing the opposite, it's difficult because all these organizations they do incredible work, but I think our staff have done the work on us on making these difficult decisions in corporate services and without the policy. I strongly encourage us to take the staff's recommendation. This is not an easy road to be going down, but we don't have the money. We need a policy, I agree, but if we start pulling and disagreeing with staff and changing their recommendations, which they, I believe, have spent a tremendous amount of time on, if we start changing our minds, then it is going to open the door to going through line by line by line 91. And each and every one of us has our favorite projects and our favorite and are intimately involved in it. And I think it's the wrong way to go. I think we need to take it for 1 year. We'll take the staff's recommendation. Because I'm sitting on corporate service, it's not that this hasn't been discussed to death. We have gone over each and every one of it. I think we've spent hours on this issue. And I think to not take the well-paid staff's advice is just a huge mistake.
Thank you. helps.
I'm very compelled by what Councillor Gudgeon says, and I'm prepared to support all of the recommendations on the table today, recognizing that it's for 1 year. I do think that we need to have, in my mind, a more values-based approach to our tax exemption policy, and that's what I was trying to get at earlier when I felt, quite frankly, cut off, so maybe that's just my feeling. So I look forward with great interest to a values-based, a principle-driven tax exemption policy, rather than something that's been the status quo for goodness knows how long. So I'm prepared to support this today in the interest of getting to other issues, and I do thank the staff for their work.
With that, I call the question on recommendation number one, the decline from the neighborhood reasons. All those in favor? Opposed? No one opposed. Second item is that the tax exemption from the Adam Court Foundation related to specifically Mary Street folio, as outlined, is declined. So motion. Discussion on the recommendation. Councillor Isaac,
Councillor. I think the Adam Court Foundation needs all the help it can get to restore rail connectivity on the island, so I will support the motion on the table.
Councillor
Mel. Well, I'm very supportive of the Adam Court Foundation, but I'm not too anxious to give a tax exemption on properties you're not using, and so that's why I will be supporting. It's not an indication of a lack of support from the very good work.
Seeing none, all in favor? Opposed? Eyes opposed? Thank you. Three, the request to expand permissive tax exemption for the, pronunciation by the Han Cultural Center be applied. We need some good motion.
I'll move the motion.
Okay. Speaking to the motion, Governor Joe and I.
And just once again, I think some of the rationale was given by staff, I support the motion. And my understanding is that once the policy is in place, if the Bayani Cultural Center feels that they still should, under the new policy, receive a large tax exemption, they could come forward with that in the future.
Thank you. Councillor Isaac.
I don't support the recommendation, and if I didn't recognize, I would move that we accept this request rather than decline it, and that would be the motion on the table. That's not the case. So I think the volume of taxes that we forego for European-based faith and cultural organizations is massive, 60 rooms or more. So I think the cultural activities provided at this center are completely similar. For all we know, the United Church or the Catholics or the Anglicans may very well do Facebook and knitting and other types of workshops, and we don't use that as a rationale for rolling back their exemption to 60 or 40%. So I think this organization does great work in the community, and we should extend the courtesy of a full exemption this year and future years as well, if that's the path we take with other faith and cultural organization.
Colvin, then Young.
I'm not sure it's terribly helpful as we get into this to play the divide and conquer. I do go back with some history on all of these, and we have taken away on exactly the same process. Some previous cultural groups who didn't fit the policy, the fact is we are keeping in place the 60% tax relief on that. And what we are talking about in the larger issue is, yes, we've been very gracious over the years and given lots, and we've actually forgiven. So it's now very difficult for not only the people who are still there to look at heading back in certain areas, but also new entrants into this. So I don't think anybody around the table questions the great work that this organization and a number of other organizations do. But it's really about our capacity to expand or not. And I don't see us having the capacity to do that. So I'm quite willing to second the motion I made, because I also recognize it.
Thank you, Councillor Young.
Just wondering if the staff could respond to the question implicit in Councillor Isaac's comments. That is, to what extent do we carry out a detailed examination of activities in other areas in similar institutions? Is it primarily that they've been adopted earlier and grandfathered in, and in the course of a review they may be withdrawn, or are we those same principles to all the organizations?
say that the majority of staff effort is directed towards new or changing applications, whereas pre-existing applications aren't given as much scrutiny. However, they do apply on an annual basis, and some of the information provided in the applications on that annual basis, which urges staff to follow up further for Mark.
I guess my only comment would be this, that underlines the importance of the review and of as we move forward, treating all organizations in an even-handed way, the discrimination being not by the continent of origin, but rather by between long-standing and new applications. And we have to recognize that if we stick with a policy where people are grandfathered in, there is discrimination on that basis, and that an even-handed policy will mean that applying those policies to everyone, no matter how long-standing their exemption, will result in some pain to long-standing exemptions, so that we, in the pursuit of even-handedness, but it is an objective we should be striving for.
Thank you. I'll call the question on item number, all those in favor, item number 3. Opposed? Carried. Council, the next item is adopting the bylaw as a passed, which includes all the other items and all the recommendations. Before we proceed on that, we have to, I think, I do respectfully want to check to see if any councilor wishes to pull one of those and separately deal with them. Councilor Ive.
Yeah, I'd like to pull a few for different reasons. So the two Bishop of Victoria properties, 1002 and 1012 Pandora. And Glenlyon Norfolk School, 801 Main Street.
Thank you. I am going to need just one quick opportunity to get those. Glenlyon Norfolk is on page 50 of 65, is that correct?
Yeah.
And where we got any of ones?
No. On the Bishop of Victoria at the top of page 5. And for consistency, I guess I'll pull the bioregional.
Page 50, top of page 50.
Top of page 50. And right above the Bishop, the Bioregional Education Association.
Bioregional Education Association,
okay. And the interest that you have is missing at any other educational facilities. I'd like to pull, I just don't see them. I've done a review once. But I'd like them to be considered individually.
So thank you. Councilor Young, do you have one concern around the youth community services?
Yeah, they could be closed.
Okay, what I'd like to do is ask for Councilor Young to leave the room. We will deal with those two first, which then allows them to come back in for the rest of the debate. Do you need to call Councilor Young?
Just to be consistent, I don't think it's a but I normally excuse myself for the Chinese Consolidated Development Association.
Okay, which is item number?
Page 50.
Hold on, is there a question about either one of those?
It's a question about whether I need to
Thank you. Go ahead.
Bioregional school, my son attended for several years.
Your son was a student there.
Yeah.
If you believe you're biased in being able to make a decision, then you should excuse yourself.
Well, those are
when it comes, we'll do it. Thank you very much. So, Councilor Pogo, as you leave, then you have someone's motion to make a motion.
To be totally fair, the should Councilor Thornton get to be here for the Beacon discussion?
She doesn't want to be here.
I'll move the two Beacon applications that they stay in notice.
If someone would do me the favor of moving the two Beacon applications and the Chinese one. So good? All in favor? All is carried. Thank you. We have Councilor Young and Councilor Thornton here. Councilor Isaac, I'm going to ask you to speak to the ones that you pulled, the except for the Bioregional Education Association.
Okay.
Counselor Gresham.
Can I just have a question for Mr. Woodland? I went to St. Andrews. My son went to Glen Lyon years and years ago. I don't think I have a bias. I don't feel that I will be biased in my decision. Is that good enough to satisfy, or do I have to leave for both those difficult decisions?
Certainly the St. Andrews School had a period of times passed, so I don't know how attached you are to Glen Lyon Norfolk School.
Not attached at all.
Yeah.
If you want to know, I refused to be in the room for 2 years after a Burnside Court meeting to do a Burnside Court. I thought the 2 year period was, but that is a personal prep.
It's been 44 years.
Yeah. I believe Councillor Helps was president of the Department of Energy. We just did this 5 years ago.
Long enough ago.
Yeah. So.
Yeah, 2006.
Okay, with that, I'm going to ask for
Richard. It's an indirect relationship, but the Anglican Synod is the name for the agent for a number of different church functions here, and my wife works for the Anglican Synod, so I should probably remove myself for those.
The Bishops of Victoria?
No, not Bishops of Victoria, that's the Catholic Church.
Okay, with the Anglican, so I missed the Anglican.
Page 52, the first section of the Place of Worship.
Oh, but that's separate from
this part of the
other. So you're dealing with Catholics, not Anglicans.
So it's really
well. I wonder if we should dispose of the school to deal with those. Is this a worship? Or going in as a matter of course?
Okay, so we'll deal with bioregional first.
Okay, so my rationale here is, although she can hear us from the mic,
See, we can hear stutter step or wing or wings.
So this was a tough one for me because I personally see a distinction between Oak and Orca, which I think is largely a nonprofit school, and but to be consistent, I apply the same rationale. I think there's lower barriers to entry for bioregional, so this was a tough one. But I think if our policy states that educational facilities should be subject to a 50% exemption, let's start following that now and not wait for the larger review. An identical rationale for me for both the bioregional and Glen Lyon, I would favor 50% exemptions beginning for 2013.
You're speaking only on the bioregional education.
So I guess can I just clarify from staff, what is the proposed exemption for the bioregional? What is the proposed exemption for the bioregional school? Is it 100%?
It is 100% because BC assessment has, in error, given them 100% in the past. That's why they're not.
Sure. So I would move that the Bioregional Education Association's exemption be adjusted to 50%.
Thank you. On the motion, Councillor Phelps.
I would support the motion because it says in our policy that that's what we're supposed to do, and I think that we should follow our policy.
I guess my only question is, are we following that policy with all the other institutions? And I think it's more important to be consistent, although we have, I think we have to move toward the eliminating any grandfathering and moving to our policy, but I guess we do that with everybody else.
The grandfather provisions and looking at options to either remove those is going to be discussed with a policy review. And that's one reason why my recommendation is just to continue with 100% exemption, because it will be dealt with at the policy review.
So point of order for clarification from me. My understanding of the policy included 50%, but we also have a policy to grandfather. So is that correct?
Yes, the existing policy is that we have the grandfathered ones. This exemption, as Christopher just mentioned, for this education facility was provided 100% by should have gone through a permissive tax exemption and they should have applied. That's the same thing that has happened with many of the grandfathered properties, including Lynn Lyon School originally, is they did not apply if they were provided with 100% exemption. And so from staff perspective, we treated this property the same consistently as Glen Lyon, the other properties were treated, and so we grandfathered them because they have been receiving 100% exemption. So in the policy report that will be coming forward, hopefully very early in November, we'll have recommendations in terms of dealing with all of the grandfathered properties.
Thank you. I did not portion this as a speaking order.
Thank you, Your Worship. I was going to bring up that very point. We have a policy that says these are the heads of different types of land uses that we will give permissive exemptions to. And in that policy, we grandfathered previous recipients into it. The reason we, and Councillor Gutchen is quite right, we spent lots of time on all of these already. We are trying to get through, because we have to by October 31st for statutory reasons, to then get to the policy discussion next year. So at the moment, these are all status quo, and they fulfill the policy as it stands. So trying to arbitrate between them doesn't make an awful lot of sense, because now it's going into a variance for the present policy. So I'm quite willing to support the way it is.
Specifically to the Ohio Regional Education Association. Do you have speakers at this time? The motion is to
adjust it to 50%.
Adjust it to 50%. All those in favor of adjusting to 50%. We have Isaac and Helms. Those opposed? Young from Joe Coleman, Madoff, Gutchen, and Ford. Thank you. Motion fails. Councillor?
No, because I think you actually want a recommendation for the recommendation that's here. For the Councillor?
I think you want that. All my nurse thinkers.
We still need to actually.
Yeah, there's nothing with that. You know,
so I'll move the recommendation as it's written.
All in favor? Opposed? Our eyes and health. Carried. Thank you.
Councillor Alto, if you could return.
Just in the interest of efficiency, I'll move an identical motion for Glen Lyon. There are the distinct issues about Pandora. Possible. So it's my rationale is the same.
Glen Lyon is 801 Bank Street.
Yes, I propose that we adjust the exemption to 50%.
Thank you.
That's per our policy.
Anybody speaking to that policy?
I think this case is even stronger than in the case of the bioregional school. The annual report reported a surplus of nearly $1 million last year in revenue over expenditures. And I've heard from many residents, joining a nearby residents who feel it's unfair that they face rising taxes every year to support city services, and this very affluent private post-secondary institution is not on the hook for taxes. So there is an adjustment taking place. We've heard that the folio has been combined, so there is a change taking place this year, and I think we should apply our policy with respect to my mind. I personally think that's a compromise. My own personal preference would be no exemption for this person.
All those in favor of the motion? Helps and I opposed. You have a list of everybody else? All those in the room? Thank you. Alternate motion, please.
I'll move the alternate motion.
All those in favor? Opposed. Helps and I thank you.
This is a distinct one, and I hope councillors approach this one with an open mind. Council provide no exemption to the Bishop of Victoria's properties at 1002 Pandora, 1012 Pandora. My rationale is that there's an active development proposal. The diocese or its agents have probably already expended the amount exceeding the annual property taxes on the development consultants and architects. And we know there's renditions in the community. There's already public meetings taking place under CALU. Council's time and staff time has already been expended on redeveloping those parcels for purposes completely distinct from education. And so I think it's extremely ill-advised to continue with an educational exemption
for those development sites. The diocese has made it, the bishop has made it more than clear that he intends to use those parcels for different uses in the very near future.
Thank you, Councilor Maddow. Councilor Thurston.
Well, continuing my deliberations with my open mind, I would just like to say through staff, what is the mechanism, the formal mechanism that would guarantee the reimbursement of taxes foregone, should it be sold?
There's actually no formal, pardon me, there's no a formal mechanism, but we do have an agreement, an acknowledgement that they will pay. So that has some leverage if they did not reimburse us and the property was sold during the year. It's the first time that it's been done.
So my interest would be in formalizing it as much as possible. I mean, I think many of us have been around this table long enough to know how proposals have come and gone with options to purchase. The cost borne by the developer, not by the property owner. So I think to make assumptions that all of this work has already been paid for by the property owner is perhaps not accurate. I don't know for sure, but that's not normally the way things go as well. And so whether or not this property is actually sold certainly remains to be seen. And I think it's perhaps impolitic of us to suggest that it's going to be developed as it's proposed, since we have not sat in judgment on that yet. We haven't had a hearing, it hasn't come into the formal city process. So I'm prepared to support it if we can feel confident that there will be some kind of documentation that we can absolutely guarantee that reimbursement from them. And if it can't be identified today, that it would be identified through discussion with the Bishop of Victoria, that they would have, we'd have some kind of a document from them with that guarantee in place.
Yes, if I can just make one point, the agreement, we wouldn't have the time to formalize the agreement prior to when the bylaw needs to be adopted by council, which is October 31st. So we could formalize an agreement with them after the bylaw has been passed, but there's a risk that at that point they won't enter into a formal agreement. They haven't explicitly stated that they'll enter into a formal agreement, but judging by their action of signing an informal agreement, there's a possibility that they would.
Well, perhaps we can help speed them up. We maybe get an addition of the approval of the tax exemption. So I think if you move to an alternate motion, I would attach that to it.
I guess the question I have, and I'm sure Councilor Hope, you go ahead and ask if it isn't a question.
Well, I guess my question on that is that my package on page 15, there's a letter that specifically says in the event the owner of both properties is sold in 2013, the city requires that you remit the amount equal to the tax approved otherwise. Table by the owner to the city of Dallas 2013. Please confirm your agreement by signing below it. It's signed below by someone who has stated that they have the authority to bind the owner. Is that not a legal agreement?
I don't really know. I would have to ask our solicitor, but our solicitor did provide this writing, but it was, I don't think it's as formal as it could be.
We have a written document that purports to be a legal agreement.
So. Yes, and we can, our solicitor did provide the wording for
so
us.
So they will be reviewed.
That's my concern.
That's a binding contract
that
I feel very confident going to court and suing. Sorry, Thorne Joe, and then you.
Also speaking with us, but also mine is all that I'm sure colleagues at this table continue to do. I'm comfortable with what is stated here and adopting the other tax, so I'll be here. Support the motion.
Thank you, Councilor
Dunn. I guess I'm less concerned with the agreement to repay than with the issue of whether the property is still being used for some religious or educational purpose. I did not support the ICF exemption for the individual property that was an issue, not because I don't support ICF, but because the use of that property was not for the transportation function that they have. I guess I would in general not support properties that are not being used for one of the purposes for which we give exemptions. Clearly, if a development proposal is underway and you drive past the property, I don't think you see kids there anymore, but
guess my question, or would not expect to see them next year. My question is, would we normally give an exemption to a property that is held by, for example, a religious institution, but that is not being used for the purposes for which we give exemptions? And if not, why would we exempt this property, which clearly is not being used for that educational or religious purpose?
There's some question to whether or not the property will be sold in 2013. From every indication from the applicant, it is currently being used for educational religious purposes and will continue, but it may stop at some point during the year, and that's what the concern is. So in the case of the ICF, it's currently not being used as vacant by the organization. So that's the distinction.
So they are planning to continue to use the property?
They've indicated that they will.
Councilor Aldo, Council Days, and we have more information.
I'm not Council Days, but I've had a conversation with the diocese and Sam. And my understanding from them is that they are going to conclude the school year at the end of June. And then at that time, they're going to assess whether or not the model applies to the religious industry.
Councilor
Aldo?
Councilor
Aldo?
Any other speakers specifically to this one? Bishop of Victoria. Thank you. Do we have a motion on the table to go to 50% or no?
Pull the vote.
Pull the vote. Thank you. Motion on the table to pull the vote. All those in favor? Councilor Eisen? Those opposed? Everyone? Councilor Helps?
I'm going to put a motion on the table consistent with the other ones and with our policy to provide them a 50% tax exemption.
Thank you. Motion is on the table. Anybody speaking to that? All those in favor? In favor of taking them from 100% to 50%? Yes. We have Eisen and Helps.
Thank you.
Motion fails. Alternate motion. Alternate motion, which is the right motion?
I'll move the recommendation.
Move the recommendation. All those in favor? Thank you. Opposed? Eisen and Helps.
I'll move all the rest of them.
Is anybody need? Full day, everyone. All those in favor of regular ones? Opposed? It's carry. All in favor?
Never is suspended.
Stop them. Motion to approve all of them, please. All this rest. Move. All in favor? Opposed? Carry. Thank you. Councilor Eisen?
Opposed.
Opposed. Thank you.
Councilor Eisen is opposed to all in favor.
Well, to the omnibus, yes. I'm presenting it to adopt the recommended council.
You're opposed to recommending to council adopt what?
Given the list as approved by majority, I'm opposed to that.
Thank you. Okay, I just want to understand exactly what you're opposed to.